There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story of
good morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, candidate. Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway on July 15th in the year of our Lord 2022. I'm headed to Studio Winterfell, getting out of the swamp after today's show. Let me begin with the news. Ivana Trump, the ex-wife of former President Trump, is a very successful businesswoman in her own right, mother of Donald Trump Jr., Eric Trump. Ivanka Trump passed away yesterday at the age of 73. Prayers for her and her family as they grieve the loss, especially the children of their mother. Yesterday, I said on the show that 9.1% inflation was probably going to be the peak because the Fed was going to raise interest rates another 0.75 point. I was wrong. After the show, the producer price gains from June were published. Producer level inflation, that's the wholesale level, went up 11.3% on an annual rate in the month of June. That's staggering. That money is coming right at you. That inflation is coming right at you as a consumer. So 9.1%, even though gas has begun to drop, that's only the most visible part of our inflationary spiral. I don't know that we're going to drop in when the July number is released in August. That's really bad news. A little bit of good news. June retail sales rose after dropping the month before. And they'll probably go up again in the next month at higher prices because Prime Day. I mean, I think Americans spent $12 billion, much of it on Prime, Amazon Prime Day. And I'm happy about that because that's the only stock I own. That and Palantir. I have a few shares of Palantir outside of mutual funds because I'm not smart enough to play the market. So I just buy Amazon and mutual funds and a little stake in Palantir. And I'll tell you right now, the drive to find value will lead people towards reliable, I mean, Procter & Gamble stuff, Amazon stuff, stuff like that. Let me check the market brought to you by Birch Gold because inflation is so deeply embedded. This is really counterintuitive. Gold fell again yesterday to $1,701. I mean, it is the time to buy. If you're going to buy gold, go to hughgold.com or text Hugh to 989898. They sponsored the market update yesterday. Everything was down. Dow off 142 and the S&P down 11.4. NASDAQ was actually up 3 points, but that's because Amazon had a good day. But, I mean, the whole broader market just down, down, down. And the 10-year Treasury stayed below 3. That's good news. But it looks like everyone is simply settling in for a long run of inflation. And, you know, here's a story from Business Journal. Online sales nationwide spiked during Amazon Prime Day event. That's not really even news because everyone, I even bought something from Amazon this weekend because the 8-year-old, Jack, the Artful Dodger, wants a Nintendo Switch, and I'm going to install one at Studio Winterfell, and so you'll be able to see when the Hugh Hewitt sign over my shoulder has on it Super Mario, because that's my consent. But what are grandfathers for except to give 8-year-old boys Nintendo Switch? Okayed by the parents, of course. Okayed by the parents. Best news of the morning, and I'll go to worst news of the morning. Best news of the morning, Manchin says he will not support new climate spending or tax hikes on wealthy, according to the Washington Post. New York Times, headline as well, Manchin pulls plug on climate and tax talks, shrinking domestic plan. Senator Joe Manchin, the third Democrat of West Virginia, pulled the plug on Thursday on negotiations to salvage key pieces of President Biden's agenda, informing his party's leader that he would not support funding for climate or energy programs or raising taxes on wealthy Americans and corporations. This is such good news because more spending and tax hikes would take a recession, turn it into maybe a depression, and it would have fueled inflation. It's like the exact opposite of what to do. This is why you cannot vote for any Democrat at any level. Not name Joe Manchin. He's not up this year because there aren't any of them left. The other ones have gone woke and left. This has left the Democrats with only one option, and it's a good option. Chuck Schumer announced he's going to move the CHIPS bill. Now, this is what Micron.com. Micron.com is a sponsor of this show. And Mr. Beard was on from Micron, and we tried to explain to you this week. I've been a longtime supporter of CHIPS. I think that's why they asked to sponsor some spots on the show, is because they know that my audience knows what I believe about chip industry, is that you need oxygen, water, food, and chips to survive in America. Oxygen, water, food, and chips. In that order. Oxygen, water, food, and semiconductor chips. And the CHIPS Act will get us the fabrication footprint that we need to run a modern military, to run a modern economy, to keep pace with China. And Micron.com wants CHIPS Act passed. They've tried to persuade people on this show. I've given them a forum to do so. And I'm telling you now, completely independent of that, they might never have come, they might never come back. We need the CHIPS Act. I hope they put some of the fabrication plants in northeastern Ohio near the water. You need water for chips. And I hope they go up there and say, hey, you know what? Warren, Ohio, Youngstown, Ohio, that's exactly where we want to produce chips and send them everywhere in the country. But whatever it is that they negotiate over the next 3 weeks, that's good news. China's economy, speaking of chips and an economy that is being driven by chips, Micron.com does not want China to build more chips. But we all want chips built in the United States. Whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, left, right, you don't want these things made in China. China's economy barely grew in the weakest quarter since the Wuhan lockdown. So they have hit a wall because they really had a terrible vaccine as opposed to our vaccine. They locked everyone down. They shut down their economy. The supply chain effects will hit us for a long time. But they only grew by 0.4%. And that narrowly misses the second quarter contraction, as the Financial Times reports this morning. So that's the bad news, because we want China to grow economically and to not grow in its defense spending. But that's not likely to happen. All right, Liz Truss. There are five conservatives left in the race to become the British prime minister. Boris Johnson is a lame duck. Everybody knows it. He'll be gone by the first week in September. So there are they had their latest round of voting yesterday, and they got down to five. Those five are Rishi Sunak, who's would be a liberal Republican in America. And there aren't any liberal Republicans left in America. There used to be the Nelson Rockefellers and the people that they've all become Democrats, and then they all became woke. There are moderate Republicans like Susan Collins and Rob Portman and a bunch of others. And I guess Rishi would say, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, he's kind of with them, but he raised taxes a lot. He's not a Thatcherite, and he wasn't for Brexit. He's still in the race. Penny Mordaunt, he got 101 votes yesterday, increasing his total 13. Penny Mordaunt picked up 16 and got up to 83. Liz Truss, the foreign secretary right now, got up to 64. She increased 14. Kemi Badenoch, up to 49. She got up 9. Tom Tugendhat got 32. He lost 5, but he's still in the hunt. And Suella Braverman was eliminated. And so there are right now at least 27 votes that have to go somewhere else. And there's a big effort on the Tory right to rally around Liz Truss. Because although she was a Remainer, she became an ardent Brexiteer. She has very good credentials on national security. So does Penny Mordaunt. Look, I'm not a Brit. Not my election, not my country. But they are an ally and they are a nuclear power, so it matters to us a lot. I think I'd prefer Liz Truss from this group. Tommy Tugendhat, had he served in a major office of state, would have mattered a lot. I wouldn't be surprised. They have a debate tonight, and they have a debate on Sunday. And they have three more rounds of voting next week to get down to two, and then they ask the 200,000 dues-paying members of the Tory party to pick between those two. And I would not be surprised to see Tugendhat support Liz Truss cut a deal to become the Minister of Defense if Ben Wallace doesn't want to do it. Ben Wallace could have been winning this race. Ben Wallace passed by the chance to be the Prime Minister. But Lord Frost came out, and he's the guy who negotiated Brexit with Boris. He's the big gun on the right when it comes to Brexit, and he said rally around Liz Truss, and he blasted. They play hardball over there. It's real Game of Thrones stuff this weekend. And I will keep you posted on Monday. I'll tell you a little bit more about Liz Truss afterwards, because at this point, the way it's gone, I just read the Telegraph and the Financial Times, and I hope the Tories vote for Liz Truss. And I think she might be Maggie Thatcher 2.0. We will find out. Stay tuned, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Micron.
Good Friday to you, America. The Friday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show underway. I wanted to do two things in this segment. The first was to remind you that as you watch over the weekend, Liz Truss is probably as close to Margaret Thatcher as we're going to get. She has the faith of a convert on Brexit. She was a Remainer, but she converted. She's their foreign secretary. She knows how to deal with Putin and Xi. She's very hard-nosed. Penny Mordaunt looks pretty good on paper, too, but a lot of jobs in a few years, and Lord Snow doesn't trust her, and I trust him. You got to understand that Boris got the job done. He got Brexit done. That's his big legacy. And then he went, as Donald Trump said on the show 6 or 8 months ago, Boris really got into the climate stuff, and he and Rishi Sunak came up with this massive tax hike in the middle of a recession. Not Thatcherite at all. He lost his backbenches, then the scandals happened. You know, number 10 had the parties, and then we had a sex scandal with an MP groping people that Boris may not have covered up, but he knew about it and didn't do anything. So, new era, new face. Liz Truss would be an excellent face for Great Britain. And I have buddies who like Tommy Tuggenhat a lot because of his military combat experience, but he's just never served in one of the offices of state, much less one of the great offices of state, in the cabinet, which is what in a parliamentary system you do is you climb the greasy pole, as Disraeli called it. And I want to play for you a bit by Don Lemon on CNN yesterday, who is clearly not happy with the announced direction of new CNN management to go back to doing the news. And Don Lemon, he gets credit for being blunt about what he believes, but this is why CNN has lost its audience. I mean, in a nutshell, Don isn't the entire audience. I like Don Lemon on a personal level, but he's a very left-wing individual. And here's what he says on CNN yesterday, cut number 18.
We sit around and we talk about these things and we want to give this false equivalence to Democrats and Republicans. That is not where we are right now. Republicans are doing something that is very dangerous to our society. And we have to acknowledge that. We have to acknowledge that as Americans. We must acknowledge that as journalists, because if we don't, we're not doing our jobs. We cannot sit here and pretend like, well, yeah, Republicans, it's a cut them a break. We want to hear whatever. They have a lot to answer for in this moment. A lot to answer for what happened with the former president of the United States, why they allowed his antics to go on for so long, why he is not accountable, why they go along with it and don't say anything. They've got to answer for that. Why they are, whether you agree with abortion rights or not, why they have taken back a right that was that was granted to American women for 50 years. They have to answer for those questions. If they come here on CNN, they must answer for that. If they go on MSNBC, they must answer for that. If they go on ABC, they must answer for that. And they cannot expect to be coddled when they go on to a news organization or if they step in front of a crowd of supporters and so or of voters or of Americans. So we've got to be so. We have a former member of the Oath Keepers who is saying we are in very dangerous territories. Territory. We have a history professor who is telling us right now that the GOP is becoming more and more associated with extremists
and that's
radicals.
And that's specifically what they were talking about. That was interesting and notable. The suggestion that there's bleed over between the Oath Keepers and they talked about, I think they brought up Idaho.
It's not bleed over, it's merging. They're merging. And we can, let's not pretend. I think people, even the former president, people who are in charge of what the American press puts out, they want to believe that we are living in 1987, this sort of Reagan-esque Republican. That's not where we are right now.
All right, that's from Newsbusters. I'm going to play that at the top of the next hour and take calls about it because of what it reveals. I've known Don a long time. I know that Don doesn't know anything about constitutional law. And the idea that the Oath Keepers are merging with the Republican Party is just about as dumb as his desk. It tells you, candid, first time, I wish he would just say, I've never voted for a Republican, I hate them. I wish he would just say that. Because then I think it would be more honest even. But I'm going to do that next hour. First, we're going to talk about Thor with Sonny Bunch, because it is the weekend. You got to see a movie, right? You got to go see a movie. Sonny Bunch is up next. Stay tuned, America.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. Sonny Bunch is the official movie critic of the Hugh Hewitt Show. He's also the host of Bulwark Goes to the Movies and Across the Movie Aisle. And this weekend, we're talking about Thor, whatever the subtitle is. And I say that because having seen it yesterday, I walked out of the theater and said to son number one, I think the Marvel Universe is played out. And now Sonny Bunch joins us to tell us what a real film critic thinks. Sonny, good morning.
Hey, Hugh. I don't think I don't think the Marvel Universe is played out economically or financially, right?
This movie I agree.
Huge box office, big opening weekend for this last weekend. Made $144 million or something. And, you know, these movies are still the biggest draw at the domestic box office, opening weekends, over the run of their lives, whatever. You know, the Doctor Strange Multiverse of Madness, which got a B+ from CinemaScore, was not a huge hit with audiences. That movie still made $950 million worldwide without China. You know, this one again opened pretty big, $144 million. So when we say played out, have to couch that with.
Let me context it. I said to him, right now, there are people at work in a studio trying to figure out how to produce 100 more Marvel movies without a storyline that can conceivably be interesting after Avengers Endgame.
Yeah, I mean, that's the problem. They need to get to get back to the way of storytelling that had worked for them leading up to Avengers Endgame, which is having a bunch of interconnected movies that were essentially episodes of a TV show that all kind of... that we're all building to a thing and we're all pretty confident. I mean, my problem with Thor Love and Thunder, and I did not like this movie either, Hugh, and I don't think that you're wrong that the MCU is kind of played out right now. They're floundering. They don't know exactly what they're doing. They don't know exactly where they're going with it. They have some older characters who have been around for a while, like Doctor Strange and Thor, that they're still trying to, you know, keep audiences interested in, while also introducing new characters like Shang-Chi and the Eternals, but they don't know really how to bring them together. I don't know. So Thor Love and Thunder, my problem with this movie is the same problem I had with its predecessor, Thor Ragnarok, which is that it's directed by a guy named Taika Waititi, who I don't really care for, but has really leaned into the whole, like, goofy Thor thing.
Camp.
You know,
it's
when
all
Thor
camp.
When Thor started, the first Thor movie was directed by Kenneth Branagh, and it was almost Shakespearean in tone. It was comic Shakespeare, but it was still, you know, Shakespearean in tone. It was serious. You know, it was a epic struggle about family and all that stuff. And Thor Love and Thunder, on the other hand, is just very it tries too hard to be funny. It really does all this weird, goofy stuff. And it is almost painful for me to watch. Now, people really like Thor Ragnarok. I didn't like Thor Ragnarok. I gave it a bad review. I was one of the few critics to give it a bad review. But people really liked it. I don't know what happened over the last 5 years, but audiences and critics alike have kind of turned against this, because this movie has gotten much cooler reviews, both from audiences and from critics. So.
Well, let me give you a theory and have you that you can only do the end of the world so many times, and so they're trying to introduce, quote, more human elements and more normal stuff, and that's why Jane is back. But you can only threaten the end of the world with eternity and or whatever it is so many times, and they did the best end of the world series. So everything is now derivative. Russell Crowe, and this is a spoiler alert, I mean, they could have played that differently to build a Marvel universe encompassing the Greek gods, but they didn't. Maybe they will. I saw the Easter egg. I just think, Sonny, do you think they've got like 20 people not writing movies, but trying to figure out how to just put, diagram a sentence that goes on infinitely?
More or less. There are things about this movie I did like. So here's the basic bare bones plot of it. A guy at the beginning of the film he's dying, his child dies, he makes it to his version of, kind of an oasis paradise, and his god is there and says, why did you forsake us? Why did you let us die? And the god is like, I don't care about you, you live to serve me, blah. And then this guy who is dying, whose family has died, decides to kill all the gods in the Marvel Universe. And he's justified in doing this because, as we see, as you mentioned, in the scene with Russell Crowe, who is playing Zeus, all the gods are kind of jerks in the MCU. None of them care about themselves. Of course, the problem here is that Thor is a god, right? Now, there's an ontological problem with this whole plot,
yes,
which is that none,
yes,
of these are actually gods, which we learn in the Thor movies. Thor's just an alien. He's just an alien with some magic, magical science that is so advanced it might as well be magic, right? Arthur C. Clarke's rule.
Yep.
The idea that these are gods is... My question is, how do you define what a god is in the Marvel Universe exactly? Is it just people... Is it just superpowered beings that are worshipped? I don't know. Again, there's like a very basic definition problem with this movie.
Exactly,
that it never,
on
never really
point.
Wants
to, 100%.
It never really wants to deal with.
And Sonny, it's okay to be deist. It's okay to, but gods have got to be gods, and there are very few even works of epic fantasy that don't have Sauron living forever. I mean, gods have got to live forever, or they're not gods by definition. And H.L. Mencken did a famous essay on the long trail of tears for dead gods that have been worshipped, like Moloch, or are no longer worshipped. We're down to like three: Allah, Yahweh, and Jesus. And so those are the three in the world. The rest of them are all gone. They're all dead. And I think that was sort of a commentary on it, but you know, it's not much of a plot.
No,
they're just more special people.
The plot is so bad here. Again,
yes,
for this definitional reason, but like just in terms of the actual storytelling, it's bad. Again, the tone of the film I would describe not as funny, but goofy. There's a difference between funny and goofy, and I'm having
where
trouble
is camp?
This to people.
Where is camp in that spectrum between
camp
funny
is
and
different.
Goofy?
Camp is when you make a movie. See, this is so. I this is a fight I have with people sometimes. Camp is when you make a movie and you try really hard to make it good, and it's still very bad. When you have unintentionally made a bad movie, that's camp.
Interesting.
I don't think you can intentionally do camp. I think camp is not a thing that you can strive for and achieve. You have to do it accidentally.
Well, that's interesting, Sonny. Is that a generally held position among film critics?
I don't know if it is. I know it is not a generally held opinion amongst the people I argue with about it. But this is, if you go back and read Sontag, if you go back and read, you know, Notes on Camp, that this is what is she is getting at, which is that you have a thing. The thing is authentic in that it is trying to be one thing, and it turns out to be something else.
You see, I thought of camp as dad jokes, and Thor is full of dad jokes. It's so bad. I mean, and there are some angles that you cover in your review in The Bulwark about the weapons, and there's some angles. It's just so bad as a plot. I mean, but the special effects are interesting. The lightning bolt isn't. But, I mean, generally, they had to come up with another world-threatening, you know, eternity-ending. And after The Avengers, it just doesn't, you know, the payoff was the payoff, right?
Yeah, no, they've got a real problem. We'll see what they manage to put together with all the multiverse stuff, but I think it's a bad time. We talked about this a little bit a few weeks back, but if you have kids and you're looking for something to go see, and you don't want to go see Thor, or you don't want to go see Thor again, since there's not really anything else out in wide release this week, Marcel the Shell with the Shoes On, the stop motion animation picture.
Yes,
I loved it. I strong recommend on that one. It's a good family movie. It has opened wide now. It's in 2,500 screens, so it should be playing near you somewhere. I cannot promise that younger kids will be super into it. It is a little slow and a little bit quiet, but it's a very good movie about family and community and, you know, what it means to keep all that together.
You know, Sonny, when you said that, I talked to the fetchy Mrs. Hewitt about it. It's a hard sell. Like, you're the only thing that movie's got going for it after you've seen the trailer. Because stop animation, it's just not that appealing to people. Right?
Well, I can understand that. And it's a weird trailer, too. Though the trailer does kind of get at the slowness of it. It's a little bit slow. Again, I don't think it's going to be a great movie for, you know, your six-year-old. You're better off going to, you know, I don't know, the bad guys or whatever. Again, there's not really a ton out for kids.
I took them to the bad guys, and they laughed hilariously through it, because that's a pretty funny movie for 7 to 10-year-olds.
Or Minions, Rise of Gru. You know, kids love, man, I took my kids to see Minions, The Rise of Gru, and they have never laughed harder at anything in their life.
Oh, you're kidding. You're kidding.
I couldn't believe it.
That's good to know for parents out there. Sonny, last question. In terms of Blockbuster, there are some trailers down the road that we saw in Thor, and they pay a lot for those trailers. Is there anything you are waiting on the edge of your seat to see?
Well, I don't know about Blockbusters, but I do really like the trailer for Amsterdam.
No, that was not attached, no.
Yeah, so Amsterdam is the new movie from the director of The Silver Linings Playbook and American Hustle. Stars Christian Bale. It looks a little bit like a Coen Brothers movie. It's not a Coen Brothers movie, but it looks a little bit like a Coen Brothers movie. And I liked Coen Brothers. I'm looking forward to that. But no, there's a dry stretch here coming up. You know, we are going to be hitting post the first weekend of August when Bullet Train comes out, the movie with Brad Pitt. I saw that trailer. I am kind of looking forward to that.
Haven't you seen that trailer 20 times? I've seen that trailer 20 times.
Well, we see all the trailers 20 times now because there are so many fewer movies.
Yeah.
I mean, there's only one big release every 2 weeks now, which I think is actually smart. I mean, I think Hollywood should get back to, instead of a tentpole every week, you know, a tentpole every 3 weeks, and then, you know, a little bit smaller movies in the interregnum, but I digress.
Well, I want to finish by going back to Elvis. I've made the recommendation to a number of people that they go see Elvis. It divides on a demographic line that's fairly significant. If you're under 50, you're not attracted to that movie. If you're over 50 and you have even any kind of distant intimation of Elvis in your life, you will enjoy it greatly. What's been the overall grade on Elvis?
People like it. It's gotten solid. I think A- from CinemaScore, which is solid. Critics are pretty positive on it. And you're right, it's definitely attracting an older audience. I mean, if you look at the numbers, if you look at the demographic breakdown, I think the second and third weekend, or the second weekend, I think was older than the first weekend was in terms of, you know, older audiences. It's also attracting women. So it's attracting older women, which has been a demographic that has been loath to come back to movie theaters. And it's doing very well for itself. I mean, it's going to cross $100 million this weekend.
Yeah, Tom Hanks already can still carry a movie. And Elvis, of course. Sonny Bunch, follow him on Twitter, at Sonny Bunch. He earned his airline miles this week. And, of course, The Bulwark Goes to the Movie is one podcast. Across the Movie Aisle is another podcast. They are both worth listening to if you're a movie aficionado. Thank you, Sonny Bunch. When we come back, I will continue with my talk about Don Lemon and CNN, but first let me remind you that even though I have been without, we got Tarzana Joe coming up too, without my relieffactor.com for a week, I'm okay. I will struggle back up to Studio Winterfell and take double. Got 8 miles in yesterday, so 848 this week, even without relieffactor.com, but, you know, I need it. And many of you expressed sympathy for my C4, C5 problem. Look, traction doesn't hurt, I don't think. And so 6 weeks of sitting in that thing 3 times a week isn't going to be the end of the world. Better than surgery, right? So we're going to do that. But relieffactor.com doesn't fix everything. It fixed the aches and pains that accompany aging and exercise. It doesn't fix anything structural. Don't think it's magic. What it is effective. Relieffactor.com, $19.95. Inflation has not touched that 3-week starter pack. Go try it. See if it works for you as it does for me and for tens of thousands of other people every single morning when they're not in studio King's Landing. I'll be right back. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt. Time for the Poet Laureate of the Hugh. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt. Time. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt. Time for the Poet Laureate of the Hugh Hewitt Show, Tarzana Joe. Hello, Joe.
Hello, Hugh. You know, the last 2 weeks have been a little unusual for me. I hear echoes of something, but I can't just put my finger on it. But I've tried to. The market is in tatters and everyone's obsessing, but the media is telling us inflation is a blessing. The Post and Times in chorus have been singing the same song. They say the cost of living has been far too low too long. Editorial opinion, every comment, every letter, all are in agreement that recession's even better. Biden has a program, and the reason he began it is he knows that rising prices are a way to save the planet. And if you're in agreement, well, it's time to do your part. Go visit a museum, glue yourself to works of art. For the earth has been exploited, time to lighten up the load. So we better tell the farmers, hey, start learning how to code. If you're feeling cold this winter, why not roll up in your rugs? And if you're getting hungry, here's a burger made of bugs. The streets are filled with garbage. Violent criminals are lurking. But they say that their statistics indicate reforms are working. There's a fight in Central Europe. Have you seen the latest meme? Go to TikTok and they'll tell you that's just letting off some steam. Well, at least we have some comfort from the White House press release, where they tell us pain is pleasure and that war, of course, is peace. That's Echoes of Something by Tarzana Joe.
It's Echoes of 1978. Joe, what year did you graduate from Demon Deacon Land?
79. And by the way, Demon Deacon had a great first round in the British Open.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. But, you came out. I was on a special report on Wednesday night. And I pointed out I got out when inflation was 7.6. You got out when inflation was 11.3. And then we were both early in our careers when inflation went to 13.5. Weren't those the good old days, Joe?
Yes. You looked out and you said, I'll never own anything.
I'll never own a thing.
Buy a car.
I'm going to have a half-grilled cheese tonight. I'm telling you, this cannot go on. But Tarzana Joe goes on and on. He is the Energizer Bunny of poetry. And you can reach him at TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com for all your poetry needs. Rates are reasonable. Poems are wonderful. This will be posted at TarzanaJoe.com. If it's working, is it working, Joe?
Absolutely. Back on the beam.
Back on the beam, TarzanaJoe.com. But the people who need poetry, write to Joe. He hasn't raised his rates 9.1% in over a week.
No, I'm holding the line.
Holding the line for a week. TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, Hugh.
Welcome back again. I got to tell you that over the weekend, one of the most significant events in history is going to happen. And that's because a nuclear power and our closest ally, Great Britain, will get a new prime minister. And the new prime minister could very well be there 10 years. Like Macron will end up running France for 10 years. And it's going to be one of three people, Rishi Sunak, Penny Mordaunt, or Liz Truss. And Daniel Pitt, pretty smart guy who I follow on Twitter, I pointed out it's difficult for Americans to understand how British politics happens. And I assume that Liz Truss has the faith of a convert to Brexit because she was a Remainer and is also the closest to Margaret Thatcher that the party members see in Parliament. The tax hike that Rishi Sunak authored and Boris supported, would ruin his name in the GOP. So Daniel gave me a brief but very important tweet. It really adds context for Republicans wondering, who are these people and who do we want to win? You know, who's best for America? Who's best for the West? Daniel agrees with my take. He said, the Tory right has struggled to find a candidate. Liz Truss was a Republican anti-nuclear socialist and a member of the Liberal Democrats until 1996. It's been only 15 years she became a Tory. Truss has moved significantly on many issues. Perhaps she is closer to Reagan than Thatcher backstory. In other words, she wasn't a true believer from the time that she was at university. She has been moving steadily right. And right now, the Tories under Boris moves steadily left. He got Brexit done, and for that he will always have a cherished place in British history. Now they have to figure out what to do about Northern Ireland and how to keep it in the United Kingdom, or not. They have to figure out whether or not to build their boomer class of nuclear submarines, and we really need them to do that. They have to be serious about controlling inflation, serious about embracing pro-growth, into the mitigation adaption, not alarmist camp on climate. They need to do a whole bunch of, wokeism is very bad in Great Britain. And of the three candidates who are left, the one who looks to me, I mean, there are five technically, but there are three with a chance. Penny Mordaunt and Liz Truss are campaigning to be the alternative to Rishi. Rishi's going to make it in the finals, I think. He's going to pick up. You need 120 members of parliament to put you in the finals, and then it goes out to 200,000 people. And so it's one of those events about which American media is silent, which is why American media is broken. Not me, but American media. It's one of those events that's going to affect your life for decades to come. And it is missing, completely, wholly missing from American media, unless you listen to the Hugh Hewitt Show. But between 7 and 10 million people are out there smart because of me. And I'm going to come back and talk generally about American media. I very rarely do this, but Don Lemon's concise display of what he and CNN believes explains a lot about why you don't know what's going on in the world, and that which you do know from legacy media is wrong. I'll be right back. Hour two of the Friday edition of the Hugh Hewitt Show coming right up. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt live inside the Beltway before last broadcast from inside the swamp, Studio King's Landing, before I head back to Studio Winterfell in the far north. And for the balance of the summer, I've got to make trips to Jackson Hole. I've got to make trips to Atlanta. I'm going to go down to the ALEC conference and gathering. But I continue to bring you the news every single morning and news from a center-right perspective. And I tell you that because everyone who listens to this show knows I'm a Republican. Everyone who listens to this show or has seen me on years, on every major network for years and years and years, knows, oh, there's a conservative guy. I'm going to be doing the Washington Post First Look later with Jen Rubin, who's very left-wing, and Jonathan Capehart, who's very left-wing. And that's fine. It's good, informative crosstalk if we don't talk across each other. You'll hear two points of view, and the Washington Post is committed to the full spectrum of American opinion. And in a divided country, 50-50, you have to be if you want to serve a major audience. And the reason I have liberals and leftists listen to this show, and I mean like daily, Talkers thinks I have 7.5 million people in the audience. I don't know. You can't rate audience the way you can rate television. You have to, you get people meters and you get surveys and you get also, and you try and figure it out. And I've got one of the top five shows in America and 450 affiliates and 7 million people listening over the course of 3 hours. Very healthy. Good impact on American politics. Good impact on the discussion. Great impact on center-right voters and especially center-right-leaning conservative voters. I'm sitting right there in the Rob Portman slot. And the Susan Collins, I have great admiration for, but I also love Tom Cotton, right? Mike Pompeo's on here a lot. Ted Cruz is on here a lot. Former president is welcome back. He's been here in the last year. Everybody in the Republican Party has a home here, and I do not rag on anyone. I also don't rag on former colleagues. Don Lemon, I'm about to play this for you, went on Newsday, I think, and engaged in basically a rant about Republicans. And people ask me, what's going on there? Because it went viral on Twitter, and I said, Don is building a raft. CNN has new leadership. Jeff Zucker is gone. I like Jeff. Jeff was very good to work with, consummate television professional. I had a lot of friends at CNN, and they know who they are, and I liked working with them. I love working with Jake and Wolf. I love working with Dana Bash. But the brand is broken, so broken that their numbers are absolutely abysmal. I mean, they're getting down to the territory of my 7:30 a.m. show on MSNBC on Saturday morning after an infomercial, because that's the only place that MSNBC wanted a conservative on, and it didn't work. And that's fine. MSNBC is a hard left station. Hard left, not left. Hard left. And the only Republicans you see on there are refugees or missionaries. And there are a couple of missionaries left. I've left. But the CNN brand doesn't have any missionaries anymore. They just have erased the center right from American politics. And they've done so with the excuse that we are dangerous. We are threatening democracy. It's all nonsense, of course. But Don Lemon gave voice to it, and people said, what is he doing? He's attacking, basically, the new leadership. The new leadership is coming in. They said, we're going to rebrand CNN. We're going back to the news. Going back to the days of being in Baghdad when the war starts in George H.W. Bush land, 1991. Back, Bernie's in Baghdad, and the bombs are falling. They're going to go back to news. Maybe they'll have some opinion people on, but they will be clearly marked like Hugh Hewitt, Republican, Don Lemon, left-wing radical. And Don is now a left-wing radical. And I want to hear your opinion on this. Can they be saved? And I want to do that by playing for you Don's rant. I think this is from Tuesday. It might be Wednesday. Doesn't really matter. John Berman is talking to him. And John Berman, by the way, becomes uncomfortable with what Don is doing because he knows the new boss is watching. Chris Licht, I believe his name is. And he tries to steer the conversation back from where Don is taking it. But on Wednesday night, I did Special Report. This is by way of contrast. On Wednesday night, I was on Special Report panel. Bill Hemmer was sitting in for Brett Baer. They're both news guys. Bill Hemmer's a news guy. Brett Baer is America's news guy. Now the most credible anchor in America. And so Special Report draws the serious news watcher. And so they on Wednesday night, they had 2.3 million people. I went and looked it up. Don Lemon that night had 500,000 people. So you can do the math unless you're a Steelers fan. That's a 500% lead for Fox News between 6 and 9. And now, admittedly, 6 p.m. is prime time. They're coming off a strong lead with the 5, and they're going into a strong primetime lineup. But it's the last news show of the day. 3 hours later at 9 p.m., Don Lemon has got only 500,000 people, and that's airport people, right? That's people who are forced to watch it in hotels and people who have basic cable. They're just, nobody is watching it. They can't move the needle. They can't create buzz. So Don, in an effort to do exactly what I'm doing now, draw attention to himself, is building a raft. He knows that in any serious attempt to make over CNN, he doesn't survive that. There is no Don Lemon show. I think he's making a pitch for a show on MSNBC here. And to do that, you have to be shrill. You have to absolutely engage in a sort of fact-defying suspension of connection to political reality. A political reality that saw 75 million people vote for Donald Trump and 80 million people vote for Joe Biden, and the Republicans about to win a tidal wave election, a tidal wave, and 9.1% inflation, and producer prices higher than that, and a leadership election, President Biden expanding the Abraham Accords in Saudi Arabia. He's there at the same time. I don't think he has much to do with it. I think the groundwork was laid by Donald Trump, but God bless him for doing it. Good that Saudi Arabia and Israel are establishing ties as the Iranian nuclear menace grows. But I want you to listen to Don and then tell me what you think is going on. 1-800-520-1234. And I want to underscore, Don is a nice guy. He's a nice guy. I first met him at Blog World 20 years ago when he was a bright, rising news anchor who did the news on weekends on CNN. But I didn't think he had politics. I just thought he was a news guy. And he went to Brooklyn College and he worked some affiliates and he was just climbing the news ladder. And, you know, you don't have to win the spelling to be a good news anchor. You just have to be able to read a teleprompter. But when you get into opinion journalism, it shows when you haven't done homework for 40 years. It just does. When you say things like Don is about to say, let's roll cut 18.
We sit around and we talk about these things and we want to give this false equivalence to Democrats and Republicans. That is not where we are right now. Republicans are doing something that is very dangerous to our society. And we have to acknowledge that. We have to acknowledge that as Americans. We must acknowledge that as journalists. Because if we don't, we're not doing our jobs. We cannot sit here and pretend like, well, you, Republicans, it's a cut them a break. Let's, we want to hear whatever. They have a lot to answer for in this moment. A lot to answer for what happened with the former president of the United States. Why they allowed his antics to go on for so long. Why he is not accountable. Why they go along with it and don't say anything. They've got to answer for that. Why they are, whether you agree with abortion rights or not, why they have taken back a right that was what the, you know, that was granted to American women for 50 years. They have to answer for those questions. If they come here on CNN, they must answer for that. If they go on MSNBC, they must answer for that. If they go on ABC, they must answer for that. And they cannot expect to be coddled when they go on to a news organization or if they step in front of a crowd of supporters and so or of voters or of Americans. So we've got to be so we have a former member of the Oath Keepers who is saying we are in very dangerous territory. And we have a history professor who is telling us right now that the GOP is becoming more and more associated with extremists
and that's
and radicals.
What, and that's specifically what they were talking about. That was interesting and notable. The suggestion that there's bleed over
right.
between the Oath Keepers and they talked about, I think they brought up Idaho.
It's not
the bleed Pacific
over. It's
Northwest.
Merging. They're merging. And we can, let's not pretend. I think people, even the former president, people who are in charge of what the American press puts out. They want to believe that we are living in 1987, this sort of Reagan-esque Republican. That's not where we are right now.
All right. On many levels, I know it's factually absurd. I don't think that Don could actually give you an account of what the Reagan Republicans of 1987 believed, did, wanted to get done, what George H.W. Bush did, why he was the nominee in 88. I don't think he really has any knowledge of that. At that point, he's at Brooklyn College and he doesn't. But that's not the point. The point is, what do you think he's trying to do? All right. I think he's building a life raft and setting up a flare so that someone at MSNBC says, we can add Don Lemon to our lineup somewhere and there's no other place in the business for him. And, you know, I think he sees the writing on the wall and the show's not going to last, and he's trying to hook on with MSNBC, and he's doing so by putting on display you know, his hard left credentials that he thinks will appeal to the people who run MSNBC, because they've just staked their future, their profitability, their ability to attract any eyeballs on being the most left wing journalist, opinion journalist in America. Now, Don is a journalist. He's an opinion journalist just like I am. But what do you think, and what does it tell you by way of happenstance about the, quote, news business? Only that it's badly broken. Stay tuned. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway. A, quote, breaking news story. It isn't really breaking. President Biden announced in Israel his support for a two-state solution. I mean, that's not news. We knew that. Every American president has been for a two-state solution, but they're also reconciled to the fact that it's probably not going to happen. Also over at the Wall Street Journal this morning, stock investors, after brutal stretch, have rarely been this pessimistic. That, my friends, is a sign to buy stock. Detective Tom, good morning in Oakland, going home from a long night at work. How are you, my friend?
Fine, how are you?
I'm great, but what did you make of Don Lemon?
I don't care about Don Lemon. I got in my car yesterday and was on my way home from a long night of work, and I hear you doing your warm and fuzzy thing with the stiff from the New York Times, and I had to turn off your radio station. What is the difference between what Don Lemon does and what you are doing and arrogating power to these people who don't have any marketplace power anymore?
Michael Scheer does. Michael Scheer is among the most read and influential good journalists left in America.
I'm sorry, Q. I'm sorry. They're impeached witnesses. They have gone ahead and sullied their reputation.
The New York Times brand is broken, but you know, Peter Baker and Michael Scheer are fine reporters.
Okay, they may be fine reporters, and let them go work for somebody who's not working for the equivalent of the Genovese crime family.
Wait a minute, what? Tom. Why are you still working for a police department that is dysfunctional? Because you can't pick up and move after 30 years, right?
No. But you choose to go ahead and invite these guys onto your show, and that irritates me immensely, especially.
I know it does, but I have Dan Balls. I have every good center, moderate, non-political reporter on because there are
I'm calling you on your stuff today, Hugh. I want
that's okay. I'm letting you call me, but I want the audience to understand, if it's the first time they ever listen, I have a lot of center moderate reporters on because I want an audience that isn't an echo chamber. I want, and I let critics on.
I can just completely and utterly disagree with that premise. Look, not to say that I'm not some whole, hard-hearted SOB. You had a great interview with what's his name from the New York Times, Brett Stevens. Okay, great. Have those guys on as much as you want. I do not want to hear anybody from the Washington Post or the New York Times in particular that claims to go ahead and be, unbiased and
okay.
And
the question, Detective Tom, do you think there are people that want to hear those people so that they might also run into Tom Cotton? In other words, do you want to build an audience that moves the needle, or do you want to talk to yourself?
Let me ask you this question. I'm sure you go ahead and
avoiding the question, segment. Detective.
Okay, all right, fine. I'll answer your question. In this case, no. Their reputations have been impeached. Any more than any other credible witness has come on and lied to you, and then you decide, like John Bolton or what's his name from the Bulwark, all right, the former guy from the National Review. Forget it, all right? They are persona non grata, at least for a while, maybe not forever. I don't care what you think of them or how well they write or how well they are edited. They are banished to oblivion as far as I'm concerned.
And
I'm
Tom, sure thank you. I got to respond, then have you respond. That's true, and there are some people who have been banished to radio oblivion, though I don't talk trash about them. The reason that has happened is because they were incapable of delivering facts to a center-right audience. Now, when I bring on a reporter from a major legacy media brand, I don't care which brand it is, and that reporter is reliable and good and knows people and has sources, they have not broken their brand. You can trust what they write, and Michael Scheer is one of them.
You're not. This is not R.W. Apple. This is not John Burns, the New York Times. It's
actually Michael Scheer is. I'm so glad you brought up John Burns, because John Burns is the perfect example of he's retired now. Michael Scheer is the John Burns of the White House press corps.
Negative.
For the New York Times.
I'm sorry. It's that they have burned. They have burned their. Okay. What about Dohart? Yeah, that's stiff on and added.
Who?
Dohart, the other New York Times reporter a couple of weeks ago.
I don't remember who you're talking about. Ross Douthat is a very fine conservative writer.
God, I can't believe how great that guy is, too. Why don't you have Frank Bruni from,
you want to hear yourself, Tom. And that's
I don't.
I want you to hear Frank everybody.
You are a weasel sometimes.
I love you, Tom. Right, we'll keep calling. Be safe out there protecting the people of Oakland. Oh, I love that. Don't go anywhere, America. 1-800-520-1234. What was Don Lemon doing? He was refusing to believe there are people like Detective Tom out there. That's what he was doing. Stay tuned. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. If you're just tuning in, Don Lemon launched continued his jihad against Republicans yesterday, but he did it on CNN Newsday with John Berman, and it's trending on Twitter, and people are talking about it because, of course, it's the unveiling of, you know, full frontal Don, and it's wildly left-wing, and I'm not going to play it for you again, but what do you think about it, Mark in Virginia? Good morning, Mark.
Morning, Hugh. How are you doing? I think it's complete propaganda from the left. From the left trying to overshadow the Biden administration's huge failures.
Well, that is absolutely true generally. But what Don is doing is building a life raft, because if CNN's new bosses at Discovery are to be believed, they want it to be a balanced news channel again. And the very first thing Don says is, I'm not in favor of balance. So he's putting himself in opposition to CNN brass, and I think he's putting his resume out to MSNBC.
Okay, and I want to give you some kudos about your Rick Grenell. I think he's top-notch, and whoever runs for president on the Republican side should have him as their VP.
Who are you talking about? I missed the name.
Rick Grenell.
Oh, Rick Grenell's a great guy. He's a great friend. I think he could very well be a Secretary of State in the future. I don't think he's an electoral candidate. Rick has left a trail of bodies in his wake as he's moved through politics. So I don't think he's actually, well, sometimes the old traditional Bob Dole running mate in 1976 is what you want, but I don't think so. Hey, thank you, friend. Rob, down in North Carolina. Good morning, Rob. What do you think of the Don Lemon rant?
Good morning, Hugh. I just want to say I thank you for listening for a number of years, and I think you're a very worthy successor to Rush Limbaugh, who was my hero, and you become one of my heroes because I count on you for, like, real information, real good interviews, and I'm just glad you're there. But as far as Don Lemon goes, I think Don Lemon is endemic of not just his profession, but people who are Democrats, who are left-wing. In my opinion, they are genetically, they are dilettantes. They are milquetoast. They have nothing to say, and they're not experts in anything, and they go on with these really crazy, shocking rants to maybe kind of feed meat to their base. But they have nothing important to say. They're not, whether they're smart or not, I don't know, but they're just so wedded to their
they're in the blue bubble, and it's not genetic. I'll tell you what it is. It is the environment, not you argue environment or genes. It's the environment of living in the blue bubble. When Don said that the Republicans had taken away the rights given by to women for 50 years, that is profoundly wrong as a matter of fact, because it is the Supreme Court that returned rights to the states and to voters as they have been trying to. And it requires that you actually understand constitutional law. I've been teaching it for 25 years. And so I don't expect anyone really in American media who is not themselves a law professor to be able to actually explicate what went on there, or much less West Virginia versus EPA. But Don was a good unveiling of what it's a job campaign. I want people to understand what it's a campaign for a job. But Rob, thank you for your kind words as well. Detective Tom can call me up and yell at me anytime. I don't need that to be bucked up, because that's why I am where I am, is that I have a broad audience across. I want 5% of the 100%, not 100% of the 1%. Right? Those are two different kinds of radio show. If you want 100% of the 1%, you can be very hard right. If you want 5% of the 100%, you have to be me, and that's me. Fred in Chicago. Good morning, Fred. Fred in Chicago.
Good morning, Hugh.
Hey.
I think that Don Lemon has shown that he fundamentally misunderstands Republicans. And the reason I say that is based on his comment about 1987. He said this is not the Reagan-esque Republican Party of 1987. And I focused on that because 1987 was a key year in the judicial nomination battles. That was the year of the defeat of Judge Bork.
Yep.
President Reagan was the first elected president who had the opportunity to appoint Supreme Court justices who would overturn Roe. If he had succeeded with Judge Bork, Roe would have been gone in 1992. President Reagan failed. He should have nominated Judge Bork in 1981. President Trump succeeded, and the significance of what President Trump did can be underscored by Edwin Meese, President Reagan's attorney general, who wrote an opinion editorial in the Washington Post on November 29th, 2021, entitled The the opinion in Dobbs will determine whether the originalist legal movement was a success. That is how crucial what President Trump did. If Don Lemon had just said, the Republican Party is different because of January 6th, if he had just confined it to that, even though his comment about merging with the Oath Keepers was
absurd.
One thing. But he also included abortion, which tells me that he fundamentally misunderstands what Republicans have been attempting to accomplish for over four decades.
Which is the return of the Constitution to its correct operation and the return of power to its elected representatives, not to the judiciary, which is a profoundly originalist conservative notion, and Don doesn't have a clue. But neither does the rest of the media. And I really do think he's just campaigning for a job at MSNBC because they are not interested in you and me. They're not interested in most of the people listening right now. Even though there are 7 million of them, they don't care. They just want their 500,000 viewers at 11 o'clock at night. Hey, thank you, Fred. Chris in Maryland. Hey, Chris.
Hey, good morning. Hey, Don is the poster child, like the Mount Rushmore of people that were broken by the Trump presidency. You know, Don and George Will and Bill Kristol and George Conway, they're my four. I mean, they represent this broken spirit of the from the Trump election where it just sent them over the edge. But he's not.
Well, I hear a lot of people say that Trump broke a lot of people. George Will hadn't been broken by anyone. George Will just didn't like Trump from the beginning. I remember George Will sitting down with the brown-suited Ronald Reagan in 1981, writing a great column on A Fresh Start. And Bill Kristol has never, I haven't talked to Bill about this. My guess is he was never pro-life and that he wanted to have a strong national security and that he didn't care what happened to the courts. The full-fledged constitutionalist conservative is very happy with the results of the Trump presidency, except for 1/6, and mean tweets. He could have had two terms. He could have won. He didn't. He fumbled the ball, and he did so because of bad advice, bad campaign strategy. It was not stolen. It was lost. And Don doesn't get that. And that whole Oath Keepers or merging with the Republic, that's just so dumb, right? That's actually, I don't even think he believes that. I just think he thinks he needs to say that to get a job. Thank you, friend. Tim in Tampa. Hey, Tim.
Good morning, Hugh. Thank you for what you do. So I co-founded an organization down here in Tampa back in 2009, somewhere around 2012. The county commission wanted to run a sales tax increase. Three ladies fought it and defeated it. Lemon came here to interview them, and I, because I was the president of the organization, I sat in on the interview. Don Lemon, I don't want to give him too much credit, but he understands what he is saying. I believe that he does. He just doesn't care about the truth.
I'm going to agree with that. Don is campaigning for a job at MSNBC. He is very intentional in what he did. He has a career in mind, and a lot of people were disintermediated from their careers by the rise of Donald Trump. And CNN broke its reputation. They invested heavily in trying to beat MSNBC into the most anti-Trump place, and they persuaded themselves that they needed to go there, and now they're dressing up their failure in patriotism. And it doesn't work. It's not appealing, but it's very conscious. All right? It's very conscious. Yeah. Tim, thank you. I want to stay in Tampa and talk to Joe. I'm trying to get as many people as possible. 1-800-520-1234. 1-800-520-1234. Joe?
Hey, Hugh, real quick, you know, I'm actually very encouraged by what Don Lemon did because it is an indication to me that CNN might return to being a news organization. So I agree with your premise. He's on his way to MSNBC or some other affiliated leftist outlet. So my take is I'm glad.
You know, and Joe, hang with me for that. Follow the money is really just Adam Smith, updated from 1776 to 2022. Follow the money, which was a Watergate saying, follow the money. In broadcast, the money has gone to Fox, because Fox has a best appeal by staying straight news right through the end of Bret Baier's show, mixing in liberals with conservatives, and then going into conservative opinion journalism. for the prime time, and their numbers, they are the new CNN, and people don't understand that. They are CNN as CNN was 20 years ago, and they have won. They have decidedly won the battle. So now Discovery Channel, led by Chris Licht, has to decide, what do we do about CNN? It can't go on this way because nobody's buying ads. They're losing. Now, CNN.com continues to attract a worldwide audience of people, but Fox is catching it there, too. FoxNews.com is almost past, almost in the second place in the some of the ratings on clicks. All broadcast is ultimately about revenue. All broadcast, you know, my show sold out and has been sold out forever. And that's because I have a broad audience and people respond to my appeals. And when I advertise, I use it and I tell people that people trust me. CNN no longer enjoys trust or audience. They can't sell anything. And the old GM, one of the first GMs I met in the business, it was 10 years after I got in the business in 1990, said nothing happens until somebody sells something. You can't sell CNN right now. You can't give it away.
Right.
And MSNBC, you can if you want the hard 1% left in this country. And you can sell stuff to the hard 1% left. So Don, it's his resume. He put out his resume yesterday. I wish people would just think like they do. If a management change is coming, you have to dust off the resume, right?
Well, and good for him. And so, you know, I haven't watched CNN in years unless I'm in an airport. And that's fine. So, you know, here's to hoping that the needle does move back towards the center of CNN.
Oh, right, boy, do we need that. Because it will make everybody better if they compete from the middle as opposed to the far left. Thank you, Joe. Ken in California. Hi, Ken.
Hi, Hugh. I agree with your theory. I think a good example of what Don Lemon did the other night is something similar that was done a couple years ago by Shepard Smith when he was on Fox.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. He was on the way out. He was lost audience and he needed to get his resume ready. So he went on a rant about Trump and he got a job over at CNBC? I don't know where he went.
Yes, CNBC.
Yeah. And so exactly right. Ken, everyone in broadcast is a person who needs to make a living. And if their living is going away, they adjust. And I wish people just understood media. They're not crusaders for truth. They're people with jobs and families, and they got to put food on the table. And if they have an opulent lifestyle, if they let them get over their skis and believe their own press releases, they're a little bit desperate right now. Ken, thank you so much. I'll be right back, America. 1-800-520-1234. Let me remind you, relieffactor.com. Inflation might be 9.1%. But Relief Factor a year ago was $19.95 for a 3-week starter pack, and it's still $19.95. And you can see if it does. I did 8, 4, and 8 this week inside the Beltway, slogging. Now, 8, 4, and 8 was not sprinting. I mean, it's a real slog. You take a knife with you so you can cut through the humidity. But 8, 4, and 8, and I'm 66. Why is that? Because I've taken care of myself over the years. I take Relief Factor every morning. Minor aches and pains do not bother me. Aging does not bother me. You need to get moving, and if it hurts, or even if you got peanut butter elbow, which is what I call it when your elbow hurts and you reach for the peanut butter, try Relief Factor first. Don't stop taking anything your doctor told you to take. But try Nature's Anti-Inflammatory System, relieffactor.com. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. Before Dr. Arnn joins us, one more segment on Don Lemon's resume, the video version on The Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. I'll get more of your phone calls in. Just an update from Ukraine. Vladimir Putin is a war criminal. We already knew that. But yesterday, a missile hit the central city of Vinnytsia. 12 people dead, including a baby. It's got nothing to do with waging war. It's just terrorism. He's a terrorist. And that's one of the reasons why I think I want Liz Truss to win and not Penny Mordaunt, though it's got nothing to do with me. I think she's capable better than anyone else in Great Britain right now of dealing with Putin and Xi. Back to the phones. Martin, Colorado. How are you, Martin?
Yes, Rashu. Thanks for taking my call. I want to tell you I appreciate your continuing support for President Trump in this ordeal that he's going through.
I hope you're supporting Joe Day 2.
Well, I tell you, my big question is, what are you going to do when he's indicted for seditious conspiracy?
I don't think he's going to be indicted for anything. At least I haven't seen anything in the 1-6 committee, which is a one-sided kangaroo show. That
tampering.
Okay, hold on. Put him on hold. Martin is a seminar caller, which is fine. Martin has nothing better to do today than call my show, which is fine. But that's why I have on leftists, is they know I'm not afraid of that. So go ahead, Martin. Witness tampering in front of Congress. Is he still with us? Witness tampering in front of Congress. What statute does that violate?
Witness tampering.
It doesn't. You don't understand basic law, Martin. So thank you. You can tamper with a witness in a court proceeding. You can't tamper with a witness in a congressional hearing. You can call up any witness you want, and you can tell them, I hope you say this, I hope you emphasize that. Witnesses are coached all the time. You know that murder boards exist for every witness at every hearing so that they get it right and they emphasize the right stuff? The idea that that's witness tampering is just fundamentally dumb. Dan in Atlanta. Go ahead, Dan.
Hey, you. Good morning. I agree with you about Don. I think if the rails came off, he could say what he really wants to say. What's going to be counting at the end of the year?
Dan, unfortunately, you're breaking up. That's too bad because I love my Atlanta 9:20 a.m. audience at the answer. Sorry, Dan. Randy in Tennessee. Randy.
Hey, Hugh.
Hey.
Hey, man. If I could just preface real fast, you bring up professors and how you got to be a professor to know this. Yeah, we all know.
No, that's not true. I do not. Stop for a second, Randy. I do not. I think you need to be a constitutional law professor to understand the Dobbs case and West Virginia versus EPA. You don't need to be a professor to understand that abortion is wrong.
Okay, that's cool. I must have misunderstood you. I think this whole Don Lemon thing, you know, call me a conspiracy theory if you want, Hugh, but I don't think that guy's doing what you think he's doing. I think he's following orders. These people are going to...
No, absolutely not. Oh gosh. Randy, Hugh, absolutely Hugh, not.
A tiger doesn't change his stripes.
No, Randy, listen to me. CNN got sold. They got sold to Discovery. Discovery wants to make money. CNN was an ideological operation. They've been sold to a nonpartisan organization that cares about its bottom line that can't make money with 500,000 people at 9 p.m. That was Discovery is different from CNN, old CNN. CNN has not yet changed, but they will.
Hey, Hugh, this is what I think, is that it's nothing but a signal to the squish middle of the road where you get run over Republicans saying you have to moderate and you have to be
Randy, that I appreciate the call. That could not be more wrong. I mean, you got to know the backstory of CNN and television programming. They're looking for a different audience so they can make some money so they can sell something, because nothing happens until somebody sells something, and they have repelled their audience and now they have to rebuild. It's not a signal to the squish. It's a signal to America. We're different. Give us another try. Please give us another try. Rudy in South Carolina. Hi, North Carolina. I'm sorry, Rudy. That could get me in trouble. Hey, Rudy.
I agree with you, and I just think that CNN has finally got the message that Don is becoming a free agent. Too bad the CBS and NBC and ABC on their nightly news, not the talk portion, but the news. It's too bad that they just don't see that people are looking for facts and for unbiased facts.
Well, this is why Brett Baer is America's newsman. He does not yet have the same ratings as one of the three old networks in news, but he will, because Brett's a newsman. And if you used to like Huntley Brinkley, if you used to like Chancellor, if you used to like Cronkite, if you used to like Frank Reynolds, if you used to like Diane Sawyer, if you used to like, in fact, Diane Sawyer and Brett Baer are probably in the same place ideologically? I have no idea. Diane worked with Richard Nixon in exile in San Clemente writing the memoirs, and then she went in the news. And the news business can't continue this way, right? Rudy, it can't.
I agree. Yep.
And Don Lemon knows that he has to leave a straight news organization, or one that wants to be straight news, for an opinion organization that is avowedly left-wing. I mean, avowedly left-wing. MSNBC is more to the left than Rush Limbaugh was to the right. I want people to understand that. MSNBC and CNN does not want that. And they tried it, and it failed because you can't have two of the same people. That's why movies don't compete against each other on big release dates. That's why Top Gun didn't come out against Thor. And CNN is completely lost to MSNBC in the battle to be a left-wing news center. And so now they have to rebrand, and that was what Don Lemon was about. I wish, don't always impose. And by the way, thank you, Rudy, for the call. America, stay tuned. Larry Arnn is back. We do what no other station does. We go where people dare not go, to the big ideas, the Aristotelian tradition, the ethics, next on The Hugh Hewitt Show.